Good morning. Buenos dias. Thank you to my predecessor Martina for the waterfall of wise lessons. I think maybe I start my lecture of today with a small video to turn back to the music again. So maybe we can start with the first video and showing it. It is a little bit more early in the program than I said, so I hope the technical staff is able to show the video on the screen.
Spelen.
Ja, en het was ook heel leuk. En we hebben ook geleerd betonen. En ja. Ook, ja.
We mochten even spelen.
Ik vond het fantastisch. Het komt maar zelden voor dat de klassieke muziek op deze manier in de stad hoorbaar wordt. En dan de performance van de dirigent erbij was prachtig om te zien.
Wat jou betreft wel voor herhaling vatbaar?
Ik zeg zeker. Ik hoop dat ze het volgend jaar weer doen.
Voor mij mag dit elk jaar een terugkerend feest worden.
So, that is a brief introduction to bring us back to what's the topic of today. The changed life and work conditions of the musician. And this was a short part of a concert in Groningen, the hometown of the North Netherlands Orchestra, in which we performed in a neighborhood on their own request, in a kind of a neighborhood park for people who are just sitting. And as you could understand and recognize, we played film music. There are three points I want to explain to you today about the situation in Holland. First of all, the changed position of the musicians and their tasks they have to professionally adapt to this changed situation. And second and third, I want to explain two conditions about the way we make these changes have a place in our collective labor agreement. So the way we formally translate this new situation in the collective labor agreement in Holland. First, I give you some information. In the Netherlands, at the moment, there are 10 professional symphony orchestras. And there was a severe budget cut announced in 2012. And since then, the situation changed drastically for some orchestras. Two of them were forced to reorganize to one. And two had a budget cut for 50%. So that really led to different contracts. The musicians in that one of the last orchestras went all back to 60% contracts. So that makes the situation very different for all the people who work in the concert and orchestra organization. Most of the orchestras depend still for more than 50% of national and local government. Their own income differs between 25 and 50%. There is a difference, probably in your countries as well, between the orchestras in the big cities and the orchestras who are in the region. the big cities still have quite a large traditional audience, and the orchestras in the region turned more than or earlier than the ones in the cities to wider perspective to new audiences. So that's interesting. In Holland that you can see the different approach from the regional orchestras are more, let's say, in a way innovative and finding new practices to finding new audience more than in the city where they can still count on the basic traditional audiences. But even though we understand all of the orchestras in Holland, like in Spain, and I heard some interesting examples yesterday, they changed drastically. And we found it important with all these 10 orchestras to make one, let's say, to tell our story, to give our position, to give an idea about our current and actual ideas about the orchestra in the future. So we wrote it down in a kind of a pamphlet to be sure that we are together on this matter, even though maybe the next budget cuts will lead to a different field in the orchestras again. We want to stress these points together. And ending of this month, we publicized this pamphlet to the national government and to, of course, the advisory committees who are in different parts of the country advising the government on the future of cultural institutions among the orchestras. So yesterday I heard many inspiring examples of ways in which orchestras try to attract new audiences. Most examples asked the musicians to come out of their routine and their comfort zone. It's not a question anymore if the world is changing, it's only in what way and how fast. That's what I wanted to stress out with this small video as well. You see the musicians first in a small tent, they give kind of a workshops to students, to school children in the neighborhood. And then the same evening they play in a park. And of course the conditions in a park are quite different than in a venue in a music hall, of course. And also the repertoire is changing. So yeah, if you are a traditional trained musician, some of them are really open towards new repertoire and towards new developments. But for some of them, well, after let's say 1 month, we play a lot of open air concerts just before the summer holiday and just after. And they really sometimes feel tired and happy after 1 month of playing this type of concert that they can turn back to the concert hall again and pick up their more the routine side of the musicianship. And I can imagine that, although we all understand that we need different environments to to reach our new audiences. What it means to the orchestras in Holland is that more and more we find that our policy, the way we make our program the year round, it has like a hybrid character. On the one way, we want to show and to emphasize that we are still the, let's say, the traditional orchestras with high quality. We attract audience for that by contracting really interesting conductors, really internationally known soloists, for example. For example, coming Friday, we play with the violinist Daniel Hope, probably you know him. So we play in the big venues for so many people as possible. But the next day, Saturday evening, 7 of my musicians are playing in a small program in a club in Groningen, in our base hometown. And they play modern classical repertoire and they mix it in a confrontation with a drum and bass collective, Noisia it's called, and they try to experiment and find the boundaries of each music and how it will reach each other. So that means that this hybrid feeling is not even spread sometimes nicely around the year and the season, but it can be off and on, week in, week out. So it asks really a lot of flexibility from the musicians to be able to do that and to have also fun and happiness to enjoy their musical knowledge and abilities in it. Physically and mentally, like the people who were standing here already said. So I think for musicians, they fear and they feel that it will never be the same. And for a younger generation, probably it will be more easier because they also grow up with a different sense of music and a different sense of things to do in their free time. And maybe in their conservatory study, they already learned that there is more emphasis on presentation and this kind of things. But it will just take time, I think. And that time is different, difficult to take in a time where we actually face so many budget problems that already is set, or that it is like a really important job for us as managers to understand this actual situation we are in, that we want to take the time to find new ways to develop the orchestras of the 21st century, and at the same time we feel the stress and from the budget cuts and the pressure sometimes of government and sponsors and fundings to rapid this change into a form which fits with new financial situations. But I think to understand it and to reflect on it, that's a really important issue of meetings of today, so we can see and support each other a little bit, and in the fact that we are in this adventurous stage of where the orchestras are in nowadays. There are two things I wanted to explain you that we are working out in our collective labor agreement, because I don't come from the musical field, and the first thing which struck me when I entered the orchestra is that really people live with their collective labor agreement. I don't know how it is in your orchestras, but it really has to do something with freedom finding on the one hand and right finding on the one hand, and being in the situation where everything is set and done for you already on the other hand. I think that's why it is so important that the things are written down and formalized, probably. One of the things what we introduced since last summer in this collective labor agreement is the personal portfolio. And that is a kind of a solution to work with the free hours who are always left over due to the programming you make each year. In Holland, of course, people have contracts for a certain percentage, full-timers, part-timers, specific in-between constructions. But of course, every year there's a certain program, and for certain instruments that there's time left over, let's say. And in Holland, we said, well, we want to prevent that. We bring the percentage of the contracts so much down that you are really so tight that you cannot move flexible to the program. But what maybe there is a method we can use these hours more flexible, and that brings us to the personal portfolio. So the hours you don't spend in the collective stage hours, they come automatically in your personal portfolio. And that means that the orchestras in the big cities, which do not travel, they have a lot of hours in this personal portfolio, then they can spend it in many different ways. I will give an example from that. And the orchestras in the region who do travel, for example, my orchestra travels to 10 different venues in the northern region. We are constantly bringing our program to that different venues and also to different open air locations. So that means a little bit limited hours in the personal portfolio. But it's really an invention which makes it possible, for example, for musicians to do to find alternatives for the collective stage performance hours. And it gives them space in according to what the orchestra, of course, needs to find in educational, promotional, or more outreach activities to do that in that hours. And in that hours, so there's more space for initiative by the musicians themselves. They can choose, for example, their colleagues with which they want to play. And they can, to a certain extent, also choose the music they want to play. So it makes it, on the one hand, it is difficult for musicians to face the fact that these, let's say, leftover hours are now even that ones are taken from them. That is a hard bargain, of course, that you have to make more hours for the same salary. Before, there was a kind of a relation free, that's how we called it. But on the other hand, you get back a certain space to become more yourself, initiative-full, for finding ways of reaching new audiences and do it in a way it fits with your own personal musical qualities and background and curiosities. That's what I think is interesting. But we are experimenting now with it for 1 year. So in this year, after this year, it would be very interesting to see whether it helped the orchestras in the one way to find new and flexible ways to approach new audiences and the market. And on the other hand, to give musicians more freedom and strength to help and find their own way also in the future to bring their qualities to the audience. There are also orchestras who use these hours, for example, to give courses of leadership to principals and co-leaders. And there are, for example, courses of mindfulness. All these kind of things can fit in a kind of a present day idea of how we can achieve a healthier and a nice environment for musicians in the orchestra. Third point is the question of appraisal and development. In that same collective labor agreement, we made space for a personal budget and a development budget. It's a kind of a training instrument. You can use it for education projects and also handling stress and stage anxiety, and for example, to give more space to presentation. And the appraisal part is coming in the fact that now we said to all the Dutch orchestras together, we need to put deeds behind our words, because to communicate to each other is something which we always say to each other that it is very important. But how? Usually, if you have a group of musicians of 80 or a little bit less or more musicians, it's not so easy to communicate one-on-one. And as you know, in a lot of orchestras, there's not a long tradition of talking to each other. Not with the group, not with the whole orchestra, not with management and office and orchestra together. So we thought it is important to, in this actual more difficult situation for orchestras, that now we cannot leave it anymore with the nice idea that we should communicate more, but that we really should stress and give the musicians a chance once a year to have an individual talk with their co-leaders, leaders and office, and in a combination you can find different creative ways in which this conversation should take place. So it does not depend anymore upon the own initiative of the management of an orchestra, of the human resource manager, whether it happens or not. So they have the right, and it opens the way to regular reflection on what it requires to be a 21st century orchestra musician who has to play good and has to perform good at the same time. I think I want to we learned a lot of lessons, I think, in the way we can achieve this goal. So I feel after 2 days in Madrid, I feel really like I have a lot of ideas and power and inspiration to start with my orchestra again in Holland. I will tell my fellow orchestra leaders in Holland that here in Spain and in France and in England and in America, they suffer and struggle with the same type of issues, but also they find new and nice ideas to cope with it. I really find it good together not to be depressed under the situation, but to find the strength and inspiration to continue and find a future for our nice orchestras. And I want to end with a short video again that gives space to inspirement that we sometimes get from individual musicians who may be more than the big institutions that we are in the orchestras, can show their individual creativity and strength to reach new audience. So I want to end up and greet you together with one Dutch musician. She's called Daria van den Berken, and you will see her way of presenting her skills and her passion to the Dutch audience. I thank you very much.